When it comes to animals and nature, Tasmania is one of the most interesting and wild places I've ever visited. About 12,000 years ago, it was cut off from mainland Australia, leaving all the species to evolve here on their own. For instance, thylacines were wiped out by dingoes on the mainland about 3,000 years ago. But since dingoes were never introduced into Tassie, some people believe these thylacines are still living out in the forests of Tasmania to this day. I wanted to learn more about the beautiful changing lands of Tasmania, and what better way to do so than understanding the animals that live here. Let's get into it. So, places like this is what we're keeping our eyes out for, because it's a real soft piece of mud right here, and in it lays so many different tracks. I can already see 4 different species of animals' footprints in the floor right now. So this right here, I'm guessing is a wombat. And then if you come over here to these smaller tracks right down here, that could be a quoll. Then you've got birds and my footprint as I was walking past. This area in particular, Tasmanian tigers used to live back in the day. And although at the moment we're not on the hunt for that species, if you were looking for them, this is what you'd be looking for right here. When they did the searches after the thylacine went extinct, they found footprints, so we know what they look like. So yeah, if I see a footprint that I can't identify as a wombat, as a Tasmanian devil, or the other species that live here, I'm gonna get a photo of it, because something as simple as that can put you on the right track to finding something like a thylacine. But yeah, I think these are just all different species of animals from here in Tassie. To get a better understanding of the animals that live here, we traveled to East Coast Nature World to see some of the species that we're likely to encounter over the next few weeks that we're here in Tassie. So this is the spotted tail quoll or tiger quoll, a native species here in Tasmania. We've actually got 3 in this pen right now. They're actually an endangered species along with the Tasmanian devils here because of land clearing that's going on here in Tasmania. What I've found is when I'm out here in the bush in Tasmania, it's so hard to distinguish the sounds that you're hearing, because Tasmanian devils, their shrieks and cries sound absolutely wild. Same with this guy right here and the wombats when they're fighting. Look, there's another one climbing up just over this way. What's so cool to see. Take a look at him and you see those big teeth at the front of their mouth. What I'm keen to do after this is we're actually going to head out to some remote sections here in Tasmania and try to track some of these animals down. Quolls, devils, wombats. But to see them here and to get a feel for the animal like this in such a close proximity is pretty cool. Right, I think what we're going to do now is go feed some Tassie devils. So these are Tasmanian devils, and what they're doing at the moment is the exact same thing that they'd be doing out in the wild, absolutely tearing apart a wallaby carcass. Now the cool thing about this is later on we're actually going to be going out into the wild and trying to track some of these species down. The only thing about them is they're pretty hard to find because they are an endangered species. In the 90s, something called the devil facial tumor disease came through, and what they think happened is one devil might have just been born with it. And as you can see, when they're feeding like this, they're attacking each other, they're ripping into the wallaby carcass, and that tumor disease got spread around a bunch of different devils around Tasmania and wiped out a lot of the population. And even before that, they weren't doing too well, because when the thylacines were getting hunted back in the day, so were these devils. In about 10 or so minutes, I'm guessing that this wallaby carcass, bones, fur, everything will be gone. And that's why people say they never find thylacine bones or carcasses out there in the wild, because if a devil comes across a dead thylacine, it's gonna eat all of it. The crazy thing about these mother Tasmanian devils is they can give birth to up to 20 to 30 joeys in their pouch at each given time, but they only have 4 teeth, so it's a race to see which of those devils can get to them first and survive. So they can only support 4 of those babies, so the other 16 will not survive every single time. It's crazy.
They're massive.
They're huge.
I really want to take creative one.
Yeah. What's his name?
George.
He's
pretty darn cute,
isn't he? Is he everyone's favourite here?
Yeah, it's I think it's pretty hard not to be favourite.
Yeah.
Like the wombats. Like,
yeah, they're so cute.
Yeah, they're just, and they've got so much personality.
Mm. Hey, George. All right, we're gonna put you down. Later that afternoon, we headed to the northwest of Tasmania to try and find some of the species that we'd just seen at East Coast Nature World out there in the wild. Alright, so this is our campsite for the night. Now, the reason why we chose this spot in particular, it's pretty funny. We were driving around the campsite and we smelt something that was really bad, really pungent smell. Now, normally you'd camp as far away from this as possible, but what we found up here was a dead wallaby. Now, the good thing about this is in the area, this wallaby is not gonna go to waste because there's a pretty good devil population, Tasmanian devil. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna set up camp near this wallaby. And maybe later on tonight, some devils will come out. We're also gonna cruise the road, see if we can spot any. If you come up this way, it just turns into really thick scrub, really thick bush. And this is exactly where these devils are living. Now, these Tassie devils have had a pretty rough run over the years. At the same time that the thylacines were getting hunted, the devils were getting hunted as well, just not as severely. But the real horrible thing that happened to this species was a facial tumor disease that came through and wiped out almost 70% of the devil population. And since that point, it's just spread like wildfire all around Tasmania. Hey, buddy. How cool is this? A little wild wombat out here in Tasmania. G'day, mate. How you going? We were just walking through the bush and we spotted this big open grass paddock, which we saw a few wombats sitting on. And this guy's just up here grazing with a few of his mates up on this hill. Now, the really cool thing about these wombats, although he's sitting down with us right now, if he wanted to, he could absolutely take off. They're as fast as Usain Bolt almost, running upwards of 40 kilometers an hour. But I don't think he's too worried. He's just up here on this hill, grazing with his mates for the night. If you come up over here, take a look at him and have a go at his two mates just up this way. Here, get in there. Take a look at that. Two more wombats sitting right next to each other. They are the coolest animals right here. I can't believe this, eh? I'm literally chilling next to two wombats out here in Tasmania. That is so cool. This species in particular is not necessarily endangered. It's still important to protect their habitat and protect these big fields that they live in. But it's good to show you a bunch of different species that live here. And that was my goal for this video. So, this right here is what these wombats will do. Let's say a dingo or something was chasing them. Well, move back a bit, mate. And it finally got to the hole. The whole backside of this wombat is just bone. It's so hard, nothing can do anything to it. But it's so crazy, just this little hole on the side of this hill, and there's a wombat living in it. So this pool right here, I reckon it might have platypus in it. It's a bit earlier in the day, but we're gonna wait here for about an hour or so and see if any come out. Something really amazing that's hard to see at the moment, but that over there is the largest bird in Australia, the wedge-tailed eagle. And this coming up here is the second largest, the white-bellied sea eagle. That's actually crazy to see them within 100 meters of each other. I forgot we had cassowaries and emus, but these are the two biggest birds that can fly. I reckon there could be something wrong with him, eh? So this quoll that we just spotted is sick or injured. So what we're gonna do, we're trying to get him out under this little log that he ran under and check him out to make sure he's all good. I think we might have to take him to the animal hospital or something. Yeah, he's really sick, hey? Get him.
He's very slow and he's not defensive at all. He's very lethargic, so there's obviously some issues. He's covered in ticks and he stinks, so there's definitely something going on, and hopefully we can help him out.
Hello, Lynn speaking.
Hey Lynn, how's it going? Do you do the wildlife rescues?
I do.
Yeah, so we were just driving and there was this quoll that was pretty sick walking across the road, so we
caught him and we've got him in like a little pillowcase at the moment, but we were wondering where we could bring him.
Whereabouts are you?
We're near Smithton. I think this will be good to show people what to do if they do find a sick or injured animal. It's easy enough to just drive past that quoll and let it go, but I'm almost certain that animal is going to die if we don't get it help. So, yeah, hopefully we can do something.
Lots of ticks on him.
So what could it be?
I don't know. It's a little female.
Yeah.
Nowhere near a road or anything.
He was on the road.
He was on the road?
Yeah, but it was a real back road. I don't think we even saw anyone go out that way.
But moving.
Moving, yeah.
But just...
very slowly.
Stumbling along the road.
Ah. Like, easy enough for us to go.
Yeah, well, you would never pick up a quoll this size normally.
Yeah. We filmed the whole interaction that we had with the quoll from start to finish, and I feel like that will teach a lot of people what to do. So on this road that you found these devils on, how many dead devils have you found on that road in particular?
So it's January 2021, 245.
That's so crazy, hey?
Yeah.
And a species that's endangered.
This was all, none of them had facial tumour.
Yeah.
No, sorry, two have. But that's only this last year that we found two with facial tumour.
Yeah. When you find a devil, you check their pouch.
Yep.
And sometimes there can be up to four.
Four babies.
Four babies,
yeah.
Yeah.
So 245 is completely conservative, and that there would at least be another third on top of that.
Yeah.
Because we know some of them are so badly, like one of them had a, it's half of its body was 30 metres away from the other half of its body. So they're so badly damaged that sometimes you can't even tell whether they're male or female. These guys would have been very close to not, like, surviving. If they hadn't been on the road and someone found them, they would not have survived any much longer without intervention.
Yeah, and so roadkill is obviously detrimental to the native animals that live here in Tasmania, but what are the other things affecting?
Habitat loss.
And I've seen it as well there. Chopping down giant forests here in Tasmania at the moment.
Yeah.
100-meter tall trees that are just getting logged for wood chips.
Yeah.
It's crazy to me that they can still clear habitat when you've got endangered species.
In Tasmania, you seem to be able to get away with whatever you want to do.
Mm. We were lucky enough to see some wild devils, probably about this size, actually. Yeah, and they were out in the daytime. And that's kind of how it should be, hey, if there's a good population.
They're really... And see, Arthur River has got... Don't worry. It's a house that's...
He's escaping. So that quoll that we...
Found yesterday,
what ended up happening?
So I had to have her euthanized because the back half of her jaw was just completely disconnected from the front. And because it had been a long time, I reckon...
That quoll would have been out there in the wild starving.
So that's basically what's happening to the devils with facial tumour.
And it's interesting because, like, I'm involved in koala rescue up in Queensland, and the research and the statistics show that if a koala is hit at 70, 80 Ks plus an hour, it most likely won't make it. But if it's hit on 60 or under, it's got a very good chance of survival.
Yep.
So it just tells people they just need to slow down. Yeah, and I think the biggest thing is, like, all this billions of dollars goes, and it's everywhere, not just in Australia, into conservation. And science and research, but they still continue to devour the habitat.
Oh.
And if they didn't do that in the first place, they wouldn't have to spend billions of dollars on the conservation.
And these guys are fantastic. For a farmer, having a good population of devils, fantastic. And it is the most distressing thing to see a devil with facial tumour. So from about here forward, the jaw was just a mass of tumour. She was only surviving, obviously, just managing to eat eggs to get them down. She was skeletal, her coat was brown, and she was the worst looking thing I've ever seen, and her jaw was gone.
So throughout this episode, I've showed you some of the beautiful native species that live here in Tasmania. But what I want to talk about now is one that used to. Right where I'm sitting, these thylacines, Tasmanian tigers, would have walked past this exact piece of land
100 years ago, but they went extinct in 1936 because they were hunted. There was a bounty placed on their heads, £1 per thylacine, which back in the late 1800s and early 1900s was a month's salary. So everyone was running out there into the forest trying to catch these thylacines. And it's a species that was estimated to only have maybe 2,000 to 3,000 individuals living out there in the wild. So it was pretty much a nail in the coffin for those animals. And in 1936, there was one more animal in a zoo named Benjamin. The zookeepers forgot to let it inside its cage one night and it died. It froze to death early morning. Now, looking into what happened with these thylacines here in Tasmania, it's so sad, but it's a big wake-up call to show people that we do need to protect our animals and we do need to protect the forests that they live in. Everyone says how terrible it was, the story of the thylacine, but there's trees that are 100 meters tall out here, which have endangered quolls and Tasmanian devils living in the forest that surrounds them. And we're cutting them down still to this day. It's crazy. But when it comes to the thylacine, I'm optimistic because I've spent about 2 months down here in Tasmania exploring some of the most remote sections of land. And there's just so much forest out there. There's so much area that people don't spend a lot of time in. And it really makes me question, if I was to go out there in the wild of Tasmania and find one of these thylacines, what would be the right thing to do for that animal? So in a couple days' time, we're assembling a little team and heading out to an area in Tasmania that hasn't been explored since these thylacines went extinct. We're gonna be camping out there, hiking roughly 40 kilometers, looking for these thylacines and trying to get one on camera. To help me on this search, we'll be talking to experts, people who have worked on the searches finding these thylacines. But yeah, it should be a pretty wild adventure. So stay tuned in the next few weeks. Expedition looking for a Tasmanian tiger is coming up. Thank you so much for watching this video. I really hope you enjoyed this adventure. Make sure to like, subscribe, comment down below if you want to support me. I've had such a magic time here in Tasmania, and I'll definitely be back in the next few months. So stay tuned.